The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at WrestlingWithJonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined this week by the headline maker himself, fellow podcaster, Kirk Cooper. How you doing?
I'm not too bad at all, Billy. Thanks for asking. Thanks for getting me on the show. It's nice to grace the SWN and on the other side of the microphone. It's a bit strange being interviewed instead of being the interviewer, so I'm looking forward to this.
Yeah, it's very weird because I'm trying to put my name out there to do interviews. I don't know why anyone wants to speak to me particularly, but I'm like, I want to at least plug this. And yeah. It is a very odd experience. Someone turn around to go and, oh, what do you like? What do you like? I don't know. I think I've told everyone the same story four times now, which will probably appear in this podcast as well because I have very limited stories. Anyway, the first question is always the same though. What got you to pro wrestling? What got you hooked?
Two words, SummerSlam 90. That was the thing that got me gripped from an early age. So I'll be 36 this year. So in 1990, when SummerSlam 90 was around, I just turned five. And I remember there was Vitz Video in Lanark, where I grew up. And they had all the Coliseum videos and I would go in there all the time with my mum and we'd look through all the cartoons, all the Disney stuff, all that kind of thing. But I always gravitated towards the shiny yellow and purple videos that were in Vitz. And I can't remember if it was my birthday or Christmas or if it was just a special occasion where my mum had a wee bit of extra money kicking over. We went in one day and we actually bought the video instead of renting it, and we bought and I picked SummerSlam 90. It had Hulk Hogan, Ultimate Warrior, Big Boss Man, Earthquake, Dino Bravo, Ravishing Rick Rude on the front of it. So it's like, there's loads of guys on this. This is going to be brilliant. And, you know, up till that point, I knew what wrestling was. I was aware of like Hogan and Warrior and stuff like that. But when I switched it on and I think first match on it, it's Power and Glory versus the Rockers, I was just hooked. The colours, the big bad guys against the faces or the good guys, you know, when I was five and I didn't know the terminology and whatnot. But the thing that really sold it to me was it was Mr. Perfect versus the Texas Tornado for the Intercontinental Championship on that show. Just hooked me in, you know, because they really built up that it was Texas Tornado's debut. And to me, like, I didn't know otherwise. All of them could have been debuting at this show for as much as I knew. But just the way that Perfect sells in that match is unbelievable. Like, it's over-the-top selling, but I think it's like a four-and-a-half-minute match or something. But just the story they told in that 4.5 minutes, the way that Bobby Heenan is throughout it, and then when Tornado hits his Tornado Punch and Perfect pretty much sells it with like a 590 dotation just for this one punch, I was like, oh, this is amazing. And then you go further on the card on it, you've obviously got like Hogan and Earthquake and Warrior and Ravishing Rick Rude as the double main event on it. But you've also got the Hart Foundation against Demolition for the tag team titles. And it was when Crush was debuting for them as well. And there was all the shenanigans under the ring. And it's etched in my brain, the whole thing, you know, when I was 5 years old. So that was what kind of really kind of hooked me in. And then obviously you grow up and, you know, I didn't have Sky or anything growing up. And like many people my age, when the Royal Rumble was in Channel 4 in 2000, that sucked me back in. You know, Sunday Night Heat for the previous week on the Sunday and whatnot, the way that all went around. So that got me back into it in my teens. So yeah, I'm very much indebted to SummerSlam 90. For bringing me into it, and then obviously Council Telly keeping me interested when I was getting older.
I know, Channel 4, we as our age, well, I'm 30, so I'm right about the same age, but we're indebted to Channel 4, I think, for keeping mm-hmm. that interest alive. Speaking of like first VHS and your SummerSlam 19, mine was WrestleMania 15. And I don't care what anyone says, that is an excellent WrestleMania. And I think it's purely because of nostalgia reasons for me, because it's my first one. Because I think if I came into any other time and I would have watched that one back and went, that's not the best one, is it? But because it was my first VHS and I've watched that so much. And it was for the same reason. We're on holiday. My dad somehow, he was like, hi, you want one of them tapes? And it was an 18, I think. I was assuming 15. And I was what, 12 or something. He was like, oh, I'll get you that. That's no bother. And yeah, amazing. Same holiday, I got my first action figures as well. Best holiday ever.
That is such an important part of it growing up as well. Because like, You go about, you know, I was daft for like the Power Rangers and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, all that when I was young as well. And it's that tie-in of you see it in the television, you see it in the toy shops. I remember not long after getting hooked by SummerSlam 90, it must have been around about Christmas time, and we had a John Menzies in Lanark, and it had like a toy section up the back of it, and it was just all wrestling figures. So I ended up, I got the Macho King, Randy Savage, not Macho Man, the Macho King, and you had the wee rubber crown that you could put in your thumb and whatnot. And yeah, I ended up amassing quite a collection of them in a couple of years ago. So obviously I'm here in Northern Ireland, but almost my family and everything are back home. And my mum had came over because she'd moved house, and she brought over all my old Hasbro toys that I had. There was something that I didn't even remember having at the time, but obviously I had Perfect and Mr. Perfect and Texas Tornado, so I could recreate everything with that. I had Akeem, Boss Man, Andre the Giant, Warrior, Bret Hart, Bulldog, and my daughter plays with them now as well. As I was saying before we came on, you know, she commandeered my Ultimate Warrior Funko Pop, but she regularly plays with my you know, 30-year-old toys as well. And it's just it's amazing that they've held up, and it was really nice getting them back, because it was at the time that I was just getting into you know what I do in wrestling now that they came in. It was a nice weekend of nostalgia trip that I went on playing with them, making sure that they were all still in full working order and whatnot. But I don't have the Macho King one. That has somehow evaded me. It's got lost over the last 2 decades or whatnot. But it must be kicking about somewhere.
I remember I was there for the Hasbros. Well, at the time, my first figure was a Bone Crunching Draws, and then it was a Bone Crunching Goldust, a Bone Crunching Ken Shamrock, and they all did the Stunner. That was their move. Cause it's the only one I knew. my draws, it lost its hand. I don't know how, but it did. It lost its hand at some point. But I went to a market, and it was when I was young, single, and should have not had disposable income, but had disposable income because I lived on my own. I should have been paying bills, really. And someone was selling Saturday market a box full of Hasbros, and I was just looking at it going, how much for that box? And they're like, I don't know, £30. There you go. I'm taking all these now. And they were just, I mean, unfortunately, I got rid of them when I moved in with my then girlfriend, now wife, just because. I've somehow kept hold of the DVDs and the videos. The toys had to go, and I'm slowly getting them back into the house, just with Funko Pops first. But no, I got rid of them. But there were some, most of them were in disgusting order. They needed a good deep clean. They were covered in paint or crayon. But the one I wish I kept was a Roddy Piper one. Mm. It was because now I'm so into Scottish wrestling. I want like all the Scottish ones in the background. I don't have any of them because Roddy is ridiculously expensive for a pop, and Drew is somewhere in pre-order hell.
Aye,
trying to get him.
I'd imagine there'll be quite a few different ones of him getting generated as well. Now they've got him with the kilt and the sword and whatnot back now. I'd imagine that the initial run they had after they won at Mania last year, I'd imagine there'll be a couple of different ones now.
It's the first actual action figure I've bought in years. I went into B&M and I saw him for £8. I was like, I'm going to buy you. I have no reason for it, but I bought it. And I went back in next week and there was another one. I thought, I'll buy that one as well. And I gave it away in a competition through here because I had no reason for having one. I definitely had no reason for having two. So to at least get rid of one of them. But I was just too excited.
That's kind of how I've been over the last year, but instead of the figures, it's been wrestling t-shirts. Like, I've never really been much of a merch guy at all. You know, the wrestling shirts that I'd bought before were all just like kind of from squarecircle.com. So I had like the People's Champion Rock one that they had done, the Forbidden Objects one that's just covered in weapons and stuff. So they've got really cool designs. And then at Mania last year, I get totally worked. And ended up buying a Hot Rod classic white with a red trim t-shirt and Drew's t-shirt at the time. And then I've slowly been like adding stuff to it. So I ended up getting the Stadium Stampede t-shirt that Jericho, that Inner Circle brought out, like the fake winners one. I've got that somewhere, and I'm considering, depending on how my paycheck looks at midnight tonight, I'm considering getting the Exploding Barbed Wire Deathmatch one, just because the novelty of it and what it means at this moment in time in wrestling.
Absolutely. I mean, I've got a suitcase full of t-shirts, Scottish wrestling ones. I've got a Hot Rod one. I've got a Frats one. So it's got Frats at the front, it's red and white, and on the back of it, it's got a list of all the wrestlers that passed away before that t-shirt came up.
Oh.
I'd actually met Roddy wearing it, and he seemed so excited to see someone wearing that t-shirt, because he never sees it. And I was just like, if I could take it off my back, I would, but I'd be very cold, because it's Inverness. So I'd be like... Oh, just, yeah, one of those weird things. Anyway.
Funnily enough, not funny enough, but the last time I was in Inverness was the weekend that Roddy Piper died. Me and my friends back home, we're all massive Motherwell fans. So anytime we were away at Inverness, we'd make the pilgrimage up the A9 to go. And it meant even more, because after I moved over here, it meant I could get a whole weekend of it, as opposed to just like a Friday night, Saturday night kind of thing. And I think it must have been one of the last times we were over. But it was that weekend that Roddy Piper died. I remember bumping into some of the other guys that I know for the football that had been to the wrestling as well, and we were like pouring one out in Johnny Fox's for the Roddy Piper.
Piper's, I don't care what anyone says, I know he's Canadian, but he's one of us. He's still going to be one of us until the end. So how did you go from watching to training and going to be a wrestler?
So, well, it's a strange story. So basically anything that I've enjoyed doing as a hobby in my life, I've ended up turning into some sort of work. I always wanted to be a journalist. That was my goal. Growing up, I always wanted to get into journalism. I never managed to make the jump to being a full-on journalist. I got my media degree at Cali, Glasgow Cali Uni, and I wasn't doing anything with it at all. Then an opportunity at Motherwell Football Club came up to be just doing the match reports on the day for the website and stuff like that. And that kind of snowballed into... you know, getting work at the Daily Record and STV covering football, covering ice hockey. I thought, you know, there's a lot of football journalists, or the guys writing about football in Scotland. I'll make a kind of a switch, and ended up doing a lot of ice hockey stuff when Brayhead Clan, or Glasgow Clan now, started up. And from there, after getting involved in the ice hockey side, the stuff, I took up ice hockey off the back of it, and I was absolutely dreadful at it. Absolutely dreadful at it. And it wasn't long after that I ended up moving over to Northern Ireland. And I tried to keep my neb in with the ice hockey stuff. And when I moved over here, I was just doing like normal sales jobs and whatnot. And I was trying to get back into the media side of things. So Gregor Kyle at the Daily Record, and I think he's the main editor for Glasgow Live as well just now, he put in a good word with the guys at the Daily Mirror over here. And I know this is I'm not answering your question, but this is the lead up to it. But basically, Gregor put in a word with me with a guy called Chris Sherrard, who's the editor at the Mirror over here. They do the Mirror, Northern Ireland, and .ie. And basically, Chris was, you know, he was giving me sub shifts and whatnot. And I said to him, look, I do hockey writing, I do football writing, any kind of sports. So it would occasionally, from time to time, get me to, you know, do bits and bobs for the Irish League over here, or the Belfast Giants, ice hockey, that kind of thing. And then I'd noticed that Kevin Nash was coming over to Belfast to do a show with Pro Wrestling Ulster. So I was like, that's quite interesting. I'm going to see if I can get an interview with Kevin Nash, because that would be quite cool. And again, another way of diversifying what I do, if I could become like the wrestling writer for Belfast Live. So I contacted Andy, who was the guy running PWU at the time. And I was like, look, Kevin Nash, come over. I'd be able, like, to interview him for Belfast Live, use that wee bit of clout. And he's like, aye, that's no worries. I'll see what I can do. So I got to like 2 days before the event. I hadn't heard anything back from Andy. So I messaged him again. I was like, is this Kevin Nash interview happening? And he's like, no, but we can give you Tucker. And at this point, there was rumours that Tucker was just about to go to the WWE. So I was like, oh, well, you know, if that saying, you know, if you shoot for the moon, if you miss, you still fall amongst the stars kind of thing. So Tucker was my first interview that I did for Belfast Live. Really just, you know, didn't know an awful lot about him, but I got a really good chat about it. Managed to blag myself a couple of tickets for the Kevin Nash show, which I ended up not using. And then I never managed to get along to it. But off the back of that, I'd kept in touch with PWU, kept up to date with him. And I'd messaged Andy, because, again, through trying to be a journalist, so to speak, I like to throw myself into things and put myself up for any opportunity. So, for example, when I first started doing the stuff with Brayhead Clan, I ended up being their mascot for the night in one of the matches against Fife. So I was I don't know if you know your UK and Scottish ice hockey, but the Brayhead Clan mascot is a 7-foot-tall Highland cow. So they ended up giving me the opportunity to get out in the ice and go around all the fans dressed as Clangus, dancing in the middle of the rink during the breaks and whatnot. So I thought, I've used that for, you know, journalistic purposes. What can I do wrestling-wise that I could maybe get into, you know, to get an experience that I could write about? So I'd messaged Andy saying, you know, I'd love to become a ref, because, you know, at that time I was, 30? I'd just turned 30, 31. And I was thinking to myself, there's no way I'm going to be taking bumps or anything. So I messaged him saying, look, I'd like to be trained to be a ref. This is my reason why. And he's like, no, if you're coming along to train with us, you come along and train to be a wrestler, and then, if you know, depending on how well you go with that, we can make you a ref or whatever. So I kind of left it at that, and then in the January they put out a thing saying they were taking on a new intake of trainees, and I was like, I might as well, you know, I could pay my fees, go along for one session, because initially it was an 8-week course. So I go along for one session, if I don't like it, it's not too much money that I've burned on it. I think it was Carol McHugh had scored a winner for Motherwell against Hearts in the Scottish Cup, which won me £89, and it was £80 for the 8 weeks. So I was like, I've got the money there, it's free money to do it. So I was like, I'll go along. If it's too much for me physically, I can back out. I can always say that I tried. And after taking my first bump, I was like, I'm sold. I want to do this a lot more. So my first session, it was JDP. He is now the guy that runs Titanic Wrestling, which took over for those from the Ashes of Pro Wrestling All-Star in 2020. But yeah, it was him, and there was one other guy turned up to this first training session of the new intake. The other guy never came back. Don't know what happened to him. He took a few script slams off me. We both did a couple of Ric Flair bumps off the top rope in our first session, and it was too much for him. But I was like, no, I'm going to keep going at this. I'm going to keep going at it. And the 8 weeks has turned into 3 years. Well, three years chronologically. Obviously, last year was a complete write-off for obvious reasons. But yeah. Start of 2018 to now, I've been fully entrenched in Northern Irish wrestling, and I love it. absolutely love it. It has its issues, like I'm sure any wrestling scene has, but for me, it's been a great experience so far. So that was my long-winded way of getting round to answering your question.
That's absolutely fine. But yeah, issues, of course. I think anyone who knows anything about the Scottish scene, especially last year, knows there was issues. But just to like bullet point some bits when you were speaking, when you speak about ice hockey, I have an absolute fear of getting my fingers ripped off. I did ice skating once, and I'm okay. I can keep myself balanced. That's pretty much the long and short of it. But as soon as I fell, I've only fell once during that 2 hours I was on the ice. And as soon as I hit the ice, I just had visions in my head of my fingers going off. And I thought, nah, I'm going to go back on again. That's probably as close as a phobia I can get with just, I'm not going near anything with ice skates. I just don't like it.
Oh, no, it's the limbs that are the worst thing. You know, it's very rare, especially in ice hockey, you've got the gloves when you're playing ice hockey, and the gloves are deliberately curved so that your fingers aren't sticking out if you do fall. But there was one night at training where we were doing a line change, and one of the guys was coming over to the door, and he went to like do like a skid stop thing, and got his blade stuck, and his leg just went that shape right in front of me. Oh. And everybody was laughing at him, but I saw it. I was like, no, get an ambulance, like, now. It is the worst thing I've ever seen. It was horrific. It was just, I don't know if you've ever seen the film Freddy Get Fingered with Tom Green.
I haven't.
No, it's an absolutely ridiculous film, but there's a bit in that where his mate is, he builds his own half pipe in his front garden, and his mate's doing it, and he trips over a wire, and he breaks his leg, and it shows that his leg, like a chicken bone just being snapped. That's what this boy's leg was like. It was absolutely horrific. Worst thing I've ever seen.
So, Sid.
Oh yeah, that's probably the better example of it for the best viewership. Like Sid said, it was horrific.
That's horrific. Such a weird time in a story, because I was watching Lockdown 2005 today, and the first match, Chris Candido is teaming with Lance Hoyt, and he goes in about not even 2 minutes in, open exchange with Sonny Siaki. Was it Sonny Siaki? It might be Apollo. Sonny Siaki. And he had to be rolled out, and then that was it. And they kept saying, oh, he broke his leg. So didn't really notice anything. And then they showed the replays afterwards, and it's just freak. The leg just buckled back, and then it did it in slow motion to the point where he's lifting his leg back up, and it was just
dangling. Yeah.
Oh, it was just.
I remember like seeing like you know, Dave Boost that used to play for Coventry. He did that at Old Trafford when Henrik Larsson did his one in the UEFA Cup as well. It was just awful, seeing that kind of thing. And you know, I'm surprised I've not seen more of those kind of injuries in wrestling over the years that I've been involved in it. But it just goes to show how safe people need to be, because limbs, arms, legs, whatever, they can just go, and it's horrific when it happens.
Absolutely. But yeah, there's always a fleeting moment in my brain that goes, oh, maybe you should just try one session, see how it goes. And then I just think, I don't want to get hurt. Why do I want to do it? What's the point? I know that I'm not going to enjoy it. I don't like getting up after like a couple hours. Why am I going to enjoy getting bumped and that? So what was it like? You say you're hooked, but what was it like that first bump? Was it like, oh my god, this is real, or what was your first thoughts?
It was a strange one, because like, going into it, I know that there's like etiquette and whatnot that surrounds the wrestling industry, and it's somebody that always looked in for the outside and listened to podcasts and read books about how respectful you need to be and stuff. I was fully expecting my first session, I wouldn't even be in the ring. I was fully expecting it to be like cardio stuff, blow up drills, that kind of thing. But it was just basically started off with a warm up where we used to train at PWU. It was an old B&Q warehouse up the Butcher Road in Belfast. Absolutely massive, massive complex. They used to use it for like loads of different stuff. It's now the biggest range on the island of Ireland. like the range, like home store thing. But back at the time, S13 was where we would hold shows, we would hold the training and whatnot. So there's plenty of room for us to like do our warm ups and like run about. So it was always like a run for the warm ups, then we'd get in the ring. And that first session, JDP had me and another fella doing rolls. So front rolls, back rolls, side rolls, left hand, right hand, that kind of stuff, just to see, you know, if we could do them, that kind of thing. Wee bit of rope running, and then it was onto the bumps. So yeah, the first bump, I took it and I kind of lay there and I was like, that's not too bad. And then JDP was like, that was rubbish, do it again. Because it's all about the one sound. It's all about the one sound. If you hit the mat in stages, it just sounds absolutely rotten. So it's all about getting it in one sound. So it took us a couple of goes at that. But you just get conditioned to it. I wouldn't say that by now I'm the world's greatest at bumping, but you know, I can cope with it. And again, the fact that he had us doing Ric Flair bumps off the top rope in the first session showed that he trusted us, that, you know, we were doing it safely, kind of thing, because he wouldn't have given us anything like that to do if he didn't think we were capable or comfortable enough to be doing it. And then from there, it's just, you know, the training and the drills and whatnot that we do. They're tough, they're hard going, but they do. The more you do them, the more they become second nature. You know, JDP, the trainers that we've got at Titanic, for example, we've got JDP, we've got Tucker's one of our trainers, we've got Rocky Starr, who was on my podcast the other week there, and Luther Valentine, who was on the first in this learner podcast that I've been doing, and they all bring something completely different to it. So with JDP, it's all about about sequences. So it's taking your bumps in the right way, working on different sequences, and just, you know, making sure that we're safe while we're doing it. Luther's classes are brilliant. Luther's not one of the guys that's going to like blow you up or do that. He rightly says, you know, for your conditioning and stuff, that's all stuff you should be doing yourself at this level. There's no need to be coming into the gym and getting blown up in the ring. So his stuff's very much about psychology and character and working on that kind of stuff. The reason why you're punching a guy three times instead of punching him five times, that kind of stuff. Rocky, on the other hand, Rocky is very much a blow-up guy. His favourite thing to do with is either a deck of cards at the start of the session. So for anyone listening that doesn't know what that is, basically you go through a whole deck of cards. Every suit has an exercise attached to it. Rocky's favourites are the black cards are squats, red cards are Hindu push-ups, and you go through the whole deck. Squats count double. So it works out as something like 112 or 114 push-ups. Double that in squats, and then if you get the jokers, then that's burpees, 10 burpees that you do. And by the end of that, we do that, and then it's like, right, matches. And then you go. Or we do a heat drill thing where basically we just like knock lumps at each other in order. Basically, you have four matches going on, or five matches going on at the one time. So that's pretty intense, but it's good and it's enjoyable. And then with Tucker, Tucker's very much focused on the drills. There's a few, because Tucker's obviously been at the performance centre and whatnot, the stuff that he brings to the table is stuff that WWE are looking for. These are the things that he's done at his tryouts. These are the things that he's brought back for us there. And, you know, you can't ask for more than that. You know, when you're wanting to, you know, whenever you want to go with your wrestling career, if you're getting the type of training and type of conditioning that's coming from the very top, then you're not gonna knock it back.
Absolutely. Well, especially Tucker, because like you say, performance center, he's seen what they do at NXT UK and is able to bring that back. I watched one Pro Wrestling Ulster show on YouTube. I was always curious about the venue because it was the Goes Insane show. So mm-hmm. Of course,
ICW one.
Yeah, of course I watched that one because I had little to do, and we thought, oh, that counts as Scottish wrestling. I'll watch that and review it. Review in the loosest possible term. But yeah, I was always curious about it because the venue looked humongous, but they only had like, I thought it was like a W3L do a show in the Fife Ice Arena, and it looks humongous, but they've only got like a little square in the middle. And I thought that's what it was, but now I know it was the foundations for a humongous range.
It was a really, really good venue to have, but only in the summer months. And because there was a lot of natural light could get in during the summer months, you could do a lot in it. But in the winter months, it was absolutely freezing. So for example, the Kevin Nash show that they did, I think that was in October, November time. And they had to have like different generators on. They had they'd big like industrial heaters in the place and stuff as well. And then over the summer, it was great. We'd had a few outdoor shows over the summer using the place because they had like a loading bay, the old loading bay out the back. So we had Restival, which was, I think it's similar to the rock and wrestling thing that you do up north, where we had bands playing between the matches. So it was really good. We also had the Celtic Cup, which was an all-female. It was the Island of Ireland's first ever all-female wrestling event. The likes of Killer Kelly was over at that. Aoife Valkyrie, she was the PWU Women's Champ. I think she was the last PWU Women's Champ, actually. Likes of Katie Harvey, Lauren Ledoux, you know, some really, really talented women came over for that. And, you know, we were able to have those kind of events outside in S13 as well. But during the winter, it was awful. And we'd turn up to training some nights and we didn't even have lights to train with. So we'd be training by the torches on our phone. So it was pretty grim at times, but it was just because we wanted to do it. You know, other folk would have just been like, nah, if there's no lights, we'll not do it. But we made it work. I think we even found, because like the place, they had loads of different stuff going on. So there was a theatre sword fighting class that would go on as well. So while we were wrestling at one end of the S13, there's sword fights going on over here. There was a half pipe in there that folk would come in and skate on. I think at Halloween they brought in a few porta cabin things and made it into like an escape room sort of thing. It was just used for like so much different stuff, but ultimately it wasn't fit for purpose. You know, 6 months of the year, then it gets sold. So we now train up the Falls Road, a place called Blackstaff Mills, which are much smaller, smaller place, but it's got working lights, so we can train in it all year.
At least fit for purpose, even if it's a little bit smaller. So what was like your first match then? When were you told? What was your thoughts going into it? And how was it?
So my first proper match, so I'd done a lot of stuff, like non-physical stuff for PWU before making my debut. So started off as being, you know, the bellboy, like ringing the bell, timekeeper, even bellboy.
No, it's bellboy now.
Bellboy. So I was doing that. Then for that ICW show, I was in charge, because I'm one of the older guys there, I was in charge of going to getting the carryouts for everybody. So I was just doing off license runs pretty much all day for Dallas and then through and Jester and Sha and everybody that was there. I then ended up doing on some of our like trainee shows, I was doing the ring announcing, which was pretty cool. Good opportunity to do that. Doing ring announcing for matches with like More Than Hype, like LJ Cleary, Nathan Martin, Darren Kearney, all those kind of guys that have been over in ICW as well, from over this end of the woods. So that was like all in my first year, I was doing all that sort of stuff. At the end of 2018, PW used to do a New Year's Eve show called The Blitz. And again, if you're into like looking stuff up in YouTube, The Blitz from 2017 is on YouTube. That's really good. That's kind of one of the inspirations for me getting involved as well. But the 2018 one, I was doing commentary on it. So I was like thinking to myself, this is probably about as far as I'm going to get over the next wee while, doing commentary and stuff. And then the next show that we had announced was a Marty Jones show. So Marty Jones was coming over, he was going to do the seminar, whatnot, and we were going to have a show off the back of it. So did the seminar, everything was great. All the matches had been posted up. So I was just like, oh well, maybe whenever the next one comes, or if they need me for commentary tonight, we'll be doing that. So me and a couple of the trainees, like Eli Fox, that's been on the Hitting Headlines podcast with me quite a bit, we'd gone away, went and got a Subway, and we were sitting watching them to get set up, you know, Subway, and then Andy, the promoter, comes over and he's like, you've all got your gear? And I'm like, yes, I've also got a 6-inch Italian BMT and mug up right now. He's like, you're all going to be in a battle royal tonight. So I was like, cool, just downplaying it. But inside I was like, yes, finally getting it. None of us, I would say, that were in that battle royal were probably ready for it at that stage. As much as in our heads we probably were, realistically, we weren't. And the battle royal itself, it was all of the majority of the trainees at PWU and a lot of the up-and-coming guys from Fight Factory down in Dublin, who had a lot more experience than us. And the way that it looked like it was going to be the setup, we were just going to be shown up, because the guy at that stage, and I've spoken about this with the guys that I was teaming with as well. Like, we were at nowhere near the calibre of the Dublin guys. The Dublin guys, they train 4 or 5 times a week, or they were training 4 or 5 times a week down there. They're all trained at the school that Finn Balor and Jordan Devlin had set up or had coached that and whatnot. Paul Tracy, I think, was involved with that to begin with as well, but it's Phil Boyd and Katie Harvey that kind of run the show there now. But the guys that they were a lot younger. So the guys like Martin Steers, Klong, Big Rab. I'm saying these names as if you know them. You may know them, you may not. But they're all really, really young, really young, hungry guys. And it was basically, it looked as if it was going to be PWU against Fight Factory in this battle royal. And I was kind of dreading it. And then when I went backstage and saw who was going over in the match, I was dreading it even more, because it was me. And I was like, how am I gonna credibly, you know, at this stage, how am I credibly gonna beat off guys? You know, there was guys that were like established tag teams down in Dublin that were in this battle royal. So I was like, okay. And then at the last minute, JDP again. He came into the dressing room and he's like, I'm going to come in to this rumble. I'm going to chuck every one of yous out except Chris. And I was like, oh, cool. And then that's basically how it happened. Me and JDP, we just basically said, like, we'll do a Rock Big Show finish. And that's what we did. There's very little footage of most of the match. There's some pretty good footage of the finish, but for the rest of the match, we all just kind of paired off with each other. And this guy Jordan Sweet that I was paired off with, I got him in the corner. We were working in one corner, got him in a tee of woe that he couldn't get himself out of, so I had to batter him and get him out of the tree of woe. just working on the fly with it was just, there was good bits and bad bits to it, but the most memorable bit was obviously, the finish where, as you can tell from my gimmick, for that first match I was wearing my glasses during the match as well, so the finish culminated in JDP taking my specs off me, hit me a few digs, getting up on his shoulder, then we went over the ropes. And all I could think of was just hold on to the rope as much as you can. And I did. I managed it. JDP is quite a large guy. He's 23, 24 stone. And I took all his weight coming over the top of me while holding on to the top rope as my back got ripped into bits on the apron. And then I crawled back into the ring and everyone was kind of cheering. And I just, in my head, the only thing that I could think of to celebrate was you know, the wrestling episode of It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia?
Mm-hmm.
Where Frank just stands in the ring at the end after caving Cricket in with the garbage can. I just did that. And then Andy, the promoter, decided to play Flower of Scotland to get me out of the ring. So it was good. I definitely wasn't ready for that. I definitely wasn't ready for going over. But I got my debut, really, really enjoyed it. Got some good feedback for people just because of the way that we did the finish. It was the first time anybody had seen me. We'd had a seminar back in October the year before with Paul London, and he'd said, you know, he was giving us like critiques as modern wrestling. He's like, everybody just wears black gear, nobody stands out. So at the time I was working for a cycling company, and I managed to get my hold of this bright blue like cycling get up thing. They basically look like a singlet. So I had that, and because I'm Scottish, I managed to get some orange material that I could iron onto it. So I basically look like a can iron brew. So I was like, that's good. That's going to make me stand out. And I was trying to see if I could, you know, make myself the iron bro or the iron bruiser or something like that at the time. I was trying to make that my gimmick. And then I was like, so this is going to stand out. So everybody kind of gravitated towards the colourfulness of it and whatnot. And I got some good feedback off the back of it, but I didn't get a chance to act on that because that was the last ever PWU show. So effectively, I helped to kill Northern Ireland's longest running wrestling promotion.
What a way to finish that story. There is footage. I saw the footage because the first thing that came into my mind was Royal Rumble 2000, the Big Show Rock finish. As soon as I saw it, and I was like, great, perfect. How has nobody used Iron Bruiser? How are we in 2021 and nobody's the Iron Bruiser?
See, like that was, as I said, that was going to be a gimmick I was going to work on, but just I never get a chance to elaborate on it. You know, that was going to be my plan. Once PWU, if we'd had more shows with PWU, that was the persona kind of thing that I was wanting to go on with, and kind of be like, I wanted to play it off as I might be the Scottish wrestler in Northern Ireland, but I don't want to be known about. I don't want to be just, you know, be thought of as what my nationality is. I don't want to be stereotyped to that, but just play up to all the stereotypes all the way through it. So, you know, becoming in, like, drinking Iron Brew, you know, I made up a playlist of potential, like, ring entrances that were all Scottish bands. You know, I was the only going to go into it, but just I never get the chance because PWU... Well, I say I killed it. Really, it was Luther Valentine. Luther Valentine killed it, and Marty Jones. Marty Jones had a big hand in that as well. But, yeah. It was a great night, absolutely great night, and I think a lot of the established guys here in Northern Ireland, they still pine for PWU, they still pine for it, and even the guys from down south that would come up, you know, as I say, like the Blitz shows that they would have at New Year were always the best shows of the year, there was just great laughs, great talent on the shows. I kind of come into PWU just as it was kind of coming to the end, because before I'd started with them, they'd had Drew had been over fighting Tucker and JDP. They had Shelton Benjamin, Matt Sydal, Al Snow was I think he was a two-time PWU champion. He came back over a couple of times to defend his championship. We had the likes of Joe Hendry coming over. Chris Renfrew was the last All-Star champion we had. James Storm had come over for one of the shows as well. So, you know, they were getting good talent coming in, as well as the upcoming talent coming through and the homegrown stuff. But it just kind of went awry after that February.
So when I was doing my research, I found out you are a former champion. Of course, the Wrestling Ireland Open Challenge champion. I mean, there's a small amount. It was 15 seconds. But are you
best 15 seconds in life.
there's a joke I had in my head. I'll leave it. Your belt guy? Was that something that you've always wanted to be a champion, even if it wasn't, even if it was just for 15 seconds?
So the Open Challenge Championship with the Wrestling Island, or the Wrestling Live as they are now, is pretty much the 24/7 championship. It's their equivalent of that. So what had happened with the Wrestling Island, they are, I don't think I'm going to do Nick that runs out of this service. They're a provincial company. They're based out of, I think it's Fermanagh, County Fermanagh, I think they're based in. So they don't run shows in Belfast. They run shows in all the kind of outlying areas in Northern Ireland. So Fermanagh, Enniskillen, Londonderry, all those kind of places. But for a couple of years, there was a festival in a town called Glenarm, which is maybe about 15 minutes from where I live. They have this like, big outdoor festival in the castle grounds, and the Wrestling Live had done shows at that for a couple of years. So at the time that came about, I was doing a manager gimmick. I was Kirk Cooper, and I was managing a guy called Lewis Alexander. And I'd got involved with them, just, you know, doing bits and bobs, whether it was, you know, just bringing talent to their shows or turning up, doing a bit of management work. But for whatever reason, Nick never really saw me as being an in-ring talent. You know, I don't know what his reasons for that were. He never saw it in me. But they were doing this this festival show at the Aldeada Festival, and I got my chance at it. Basically, I was there just for one of the days. They did 2 days. I was there on Saturday, and I was involved in 3 matches on that. But the one where I won the belt wasn't even a match. Lewis Alexander won the belt off of PJ Stars, I think it was. And as I was managing Lewis at the time, we were very happy that Lewis had won it. We were jumping about in the ring, and I accidentally fell over on top of him. And the referee counted that as a pin because I was on him for 3 seconds, and I got the belt, which Lewis wasn't too happy about. So I had to relinquish the belt back to him because I was his gaffer, I was his manager. So I relinquished it. So technically, I've never actually lost the Open Challenge Championship with the Wrestling Island. I merely relinquished it to Lewis Alexander. Yeah, I think there was like, I think anybody that was at that show won it that day, to be honest. The merch guy won it at one point. I think Haley, the referee, I think she won it at some point as well. But it was good fun. And it's a nice belt as well. It's like a nice bit of kit to have. And, you know, it was a good way of winding folk up as well, to say that I'm a former champion, because, you know, I'm me. I'm just a guy with a podcast more than I'm a wrestler these days, but at least I can say that I've held a belt at some point.
Exactly. Was it the Wrestling Ireland that you had that incident with a fan dressed in a Brazil flag?
It was, yeah. So I'd been on holiday in Lanzarote for a week, and I came back, and I'd been messaged while on holiday saying, look, we're doing this show in Banbridge. Do you want to come along and do a bit on it? So again, it was strange, as Nick had said, he'd never seen me as an in-ring talent, but he said, look, you can come and you can manage Lewis Alexander at this one. So we went to the show in Banbridge. It was Saturday night. It was in a chapel. It was in an annex to a chapel in Banbridge. And I think in total there was about 12 people. 12 people turned up. But from the very get-go, there was this very loud pensioner that was in the crowd. She was one of the Dirty Dozen. And she was effing and jeffing the whole way through. But because there was very few people there, the guy running the show couldn't kick her out because she would take like 4 people with him, with her. So he had to get on the mic at various points during the night to tell her to be quiet and stuff. So it gets to the match that we have. And one of the things about the Wrestling Island is they love a gimmick match. So it was this tornado thing that was going on for basically, I can't even remember what the rules of it were, but basically there was like, I think there was 8 of us, all eight, well, nine of us, including me, in the match in total. Six down the ring, two in the ring at any one time, whatnot. So I was doing my heel gimmick, my heel manager gimmick. And I got up in the ring apron to help Lewis out. And I just felt this tug on my trousers. Now, because there were so many other guys outside the ring, I was thinking it was, you know, maybe Mitch Baxter or Pyro or Manny Link Waddle, whoever it was. And I turned around and it was this woman that had been shouting in Effing and Jeffing all night. She was like tugging me off the side of the ring. And I was like, it was a good job that I'd looked down, because I could have like kicked her, I could have like, you know, dropped down, whatever, I could have done anything to her. But she just would not think it. But she was stopping me from getting to the next spot in the match. So eventually we managed to get to it. And I was like, I was a bit close. And then at the finish of the match, I was involved again, you know, trying to do a wee bit of distraction stuff again on the apron. And I get super kicked off the apron, took my bump. And as I took my bump, this woman just started running for me. She was coming at me. And I was like, I don't know what to do. But luckily enough, one of the women that she was with managed to like reel her back in. But what I didn't realise was, until after the match came back, Hayley, who was left, and she was like, you know that you were like a foot away from landing on that woman when you took the bump? I hadn't realised she was pretty much right behind me at the time that I took the super kick. It just I suppose the way I look at it was, I was doing my job right, you know, I was getting a reaction off of it, and I'd managed to work up to that point, but it was pretty daft. And then she ended up getting huckled out of the venue like just before the final match, because she tried to steal one of the masks that one of the wrestlers was wearing. He'd been demasked in the match or something, and she picked it up and just tried to leave, but she ended up having to get wrestled by someone at the merch stand so they could get it back. But it was quite the experience for my first time in management.
So, well, she had a fun night then. Yep. So I kind of brought it up because, again, I'm doing my research, as any good person who pretends to be a journalist does.
And to be honest, there's not an awful lot of research that you can do, because I've not had an awful lot of matches.
Yeah, I've got half a pages of notes here. I did enough. I've got big writing. So I bring that one up because there was another person in that match, and not that we have much in common, but we're both listeners to the Wrestling Daft podcast.
Yes.
And of course, there's a man in that match that they love, that we all love, his name being Bingo Balance.
Bingo Balance, yes.
I don't know how much you were involved getting him on that show, but I know that John messaged me going, do you know anyone that'll know how to get Bingo Balance? And I was like, he works at WrestleZone when he's over here. Contact them. That's the best place to go. And I was so excited when they appeared in the Christmas show. Spoilers to anyone who's still catching up.
Yeah.
But you've made a couple appearances on Wrestling Daft. So mm-hmm. this leads us into talking about your more podcasts and stuff. Before I do that, your first show was Kelvin Brawl, which is a huge show to be your first. It's quite a big one, so to speak. So what was it like being at Kelvin Brawl?
It was amazing. I was looking through an old laptop the other week there, in prep for hitting the headlines, and I found all the photographs from I think it was an HTC One at the time, because I've got all these. I used to work in a phone shop, so I'm meticulous with like saving my stuff under, you know, whatever phone I had at the time. But it was my good lady wife. She had got the tickets for me, I think, for my birthday or something, because we were both massive Burniston fans more than anything. Massive Burniston fans, and obviously still game as well. So that kind of catered to my wife's side of things. Whereas, you know, I was quite into the wrestling and whatnot. And we tried to get tickets for Orrin War, but couldn't get them. By the time we get into it, we'd missed out on it. And it was at the time, I think it was, that must have been about the time that the Insane Fight Club stuff had been on as well. Because I had surprised my missus with tickets to a show that Grado was on. It's like, oh, this will be brilliant. But it was like one of the pavilion shows. And it was me and my missus and just kids. just kids and their parents at it. And me and my missus just eating Magnums in the middle of the pavilion, watching, Davey Blaze hot off his Take Me Out stint. He was on it. I think he pulled double duty that night. He was a lucha wrestler as well as being himself on it. But eventually we managed to get to a proper show as such in the Kelvin Brawl, and it was fantastic. It was absolutely amazing. Just it reignited my passion for wrestling, because as I've said before, you know, SummerSlam 90 started it for me. I dipped in and out with that issue either and whatnot, and then I kind of fell back into it when I was at uni and stuff, and then fell out of it again. But when there was that crossover with Burniston and Still Game and whatnot, I was like, I need to check this out. I need to see what the scene is like. And we were front row for it. So just the whole spectacle of it as well was unreal. You know, Wolfgang coming out on his bike. You know, that blew my mind. That blew my mind. Seeing something with that kind of production level on what I thought was such a small scale. But looking back on it now, it is probably one of the most iconic nights in Scottish wrestling. And then, you know, with Frankie Boyle doing the run in at the end and whatnot, it was just a really special night. I didn't realise Chris Toll was involved with the wrestling either. I would see him every day walking through Central Station when I was going to my work, because he's quite a hard guy to miss. And then all of a sudden he's popping up next to Greg Hempel in the middle of a wrestling night. I'm like, I know that guy. And I think that's what it kind of hit me. It's just, it's regular guys in Scotland, you know, that at the time, you know, they would have had day jobs, they would have been at uni, they'd have been doing this, they'd have been doing that. But on the weekends or in the special nights, they would be going out there and performing and putting on shows of that kind of calibre. I think, like, Kenny Williams, he was reffing some of the matches that night. They had Noam Dar, Lionheart, I think, on that as well. There was a bit where Noam did a suicide dive at the ring, but Lionheart was at the other side. He just completely get mixed up with where he was. Everything was like, you effed up. And I was like, this is proper wrestling. This feels like a WWE kind of thing. But unfortunately, after that, I never got a chance to get to another ICW show off the back of that, because it was a few months later we moved over here to Belfast. But since then, ICW did a couple of shows over here. They obviously did the PWU one. They did one of their own at Mandela Hall. And there's always been that affinity for ICW and Scottish wrestling that I've had since I've got into it. And again, like, not that I'm saying that I'm ever going to make it back over the water to wrestle for ICW or that. It's a pipe dream at the very most. But I think it is... It was one of the kind of sparks for me to get involved with it a lot more than just being a passive fan.
I don't know about you, but it was when I was on Wrestling Daft for a very brief run in. I think I was the pilot for the run in because I somehow was on it, and then after about 2 weeks later, they did the run in segment, and I barely watched Burniston. I watched it all when it was on Netflix, and that was about it. It wasn't like, oh my God, Burniston. But even I was like, holy, I'm speaking to Grado and Rob Florence here. These are actual people that are actually a big deal in Scotland. It's a very weird experience. So from that, when did Hitting the Headlines start then? Were you doing interviews with WWE stars for Mirror and Belfast Live, or was that kind of all at the same time?
Yeah, so the interviews, I'd been doing the interviews for about a year, I think. Basically, pretty much from that Tucker interview and to starting training with PWU and all the first few shows that I was involved in. That was basically my reason. It was the reason that they kept me around after the initial 8 weeks, because they had that free association with the press, essentially. So I was doing the interviews. So over the course of that first year, I had interviewed Tucker. I had interviewed Chris Jericho, because Fozzy had been touring So I managed to get an interview with him, and I've balls that up, something not in. Again, on what you can hear it on one of the older episodes of Hitting the Headlines. I put that out last year. I offended him, something not in, by trying to make a joke. It just did not land at all. Off the back of that, whenever WWE were coming to Belfast, I would get interviews. So I've interviewed the likes of Samoa Joe, Finn Balor, Sheamus. I interviewed Sheamus from the back of my 2001 Ford Focus in a car park on the outskirts of Belfast, just phoning him up. Likewise with Finn Balor. Samoa Joe, that was at the Odyssey, that was at the venue. I interviewed Alexa Bliss in a hotel room, which was pretty sweet. She was lovely. She was an absolute doll to speak to. Again, almost offended her by accident. And that's where by doing those things by accident, that's what kind of paved the way for the way that Hitting the Headlines has been going recently. Because that when I first started doing the podcast, and I still maintain to this day, even regardless of, you know, any feedback I've got on being just basically a chance for me to get myself over, the reason that I do the podcast is to help the guys and girls at Titanic Wrestling and PW at the time and whoever else was coming on, to help them try and develop a bit of their character as well. Because I think with a lot of the guys, and I don't know what your opinion is on it, Billy, but with the likes of ICW, for example, there's guys on there that maybe, there's guys in ICW that you look at and you're like, yes, he's a wrestler. And there's other guys that you look at and you're like, I wouldn't be able to tell he's a wrestler if I saw him in the street, kind of thing. But obviously they are. And it's wrestling has become that all-encompassing thing that anybody that's willing to do it can do it. You don't need to be a Batista or a Lex Luger or a Hulk Hogan to be a wrestler, as long as you can bring something to the table with it. And I think that's probably the same in any training school. And with PWU, we've got guys that are physically... We've got physical specimens, like obviously we've got Tucker. There's a lad who I think is going to be our sort of biggest star called Jordy Boy. You know, that looks, these guys look like wrestlers. James Toner as well. He's another one of our guys that's absolutely built. And then you've got guys like me that, to coin Grado, look like a bag of milk. And you've got guys that are kind of in between and stuff. So I think being able to have a character, if I mean, certainly, you know, obviously, everybody needs a character, but the guys that are maybe less muscular, less that kind of thing, having strong characters is something that's going to help them. So I was thinking, if I can do this podcast, get some of the up-and-coming talent on, gives them a chance to develop character, that kind of thing. And that had always been the case of it. But when I first started doing it, I didn't want it to just be, again, no disrespect to you, Billy, I didn't want it just to be an interview podcast. I wanted it to be something that was a wee bit different. So that's why I incorporated the headline stuff into it. And that's why I incorporated the character work and tried to put a wee angle or a wee story into every episode. So the first lot I'd done, I managed to do that quite well. Then I stopped doing it because PWU went down the toilet. Then I kind of brought it back when Titanic started up. But I wouldn't say I got a bit of heat for it, but there was definitely people that were questioning why I would be doing it. You know, who am I? You know, I'm some Scotsman that's got no ties to the past of Northern Irish wrestling. You know, I'm not the person that would be doing this. But I was like, you know what? Nobody else is doing it, so why not? And again, it's an opportunity for me to build my character. It's an opportunity for other people to come on and build their character as well. So I stopped doing it for then. And then last year, I'd done it. So this must be like season four, if I'm breaking down the seasons that we're on now. Last year's one was going great. I wasn't doing any of the character work on it. It was more kind of straightforward interviews. It was when lockdown started as well, so I was getting maybe like three or four of the guys on. We were having quizzes. We were doing, there was kind of a different format to it. And then Speaking Out happened, and it wasn't fun to be doing it. It really wasn't fun to be doing it then, because people didn't want to be coming on. People that had booked to come on or that had been looking to get on that kind of changed. So I was just like, I just adapted for then. And then when we get put into lockdown again at the start of this year, I was like, I'm just going to bring it back, but I'm going to do it in a way that I can sort of build stuff towards, with the hope that by the time we get back to shows, the guys that are going to be on those shows have had a chance to, you know, flex a wee bit on the podcast, get their names out there again. And don't get me wrong, I'm under no illusions that, you know, I'm a very niche audience. Even in Northern Ireland, it's a very niche audience. I'm happy as Larry with the amount of listens that I'm getting and the views that I'm getting on YouTube with it. And I think that it is doing well enough that people are engaging with it, and we're, you know, getting a decent number every week, or decent enough for me anyway. But most importantly, it's getting a bit of airtime for the guys that are going to be at the forefront of the scene by the time we get back to doing shows. Because I think, because it's been so long since we've had any, people are going to need a refresher on who people are, of, you know, who guys are, what their gimmicks are, what their characters are, that kind of thing. And through the podcast, I'm hoping that I've been able to give people that kind of platform to show off. Like, for example, Bobby Diamond last week. Bobby's character's not really changed much in the time that I've known him, but the one thing you can say about him is that he has a character. And just maybe even giving people that wee reminder of how much of a bitch he can be sometimes, or how catty he is. You know, it's the podcast giving a wee platform for that.
I mean, I know you're saying no disrespect to me. I'm just, I have no idea what I'm doing still at this point. And when this one goes out, it will be the 54th episode I've recorded. Mm. I don't know how I've gotten this far, to be honest.
I'm the same. I'm exactly the same. It's such a... Podcasting is such a weird thing. Like, it's... As I said earlier on, at this stage in my wrestling career, I am a podcaster. And it's just such a weird thing, and how it's so deeply entrenched in wrestling. Like there's so many different wrestling podcasts. And it is, like, for me anyway, it is all about, you know, making it different, giving it an angle, giving it something that no one else is doing on there. And, you know, I was listening to, in fact, Tucker was on a podcast over the weekend, and I was listening to that. And, you know, it's great getting that kind of insight into you know, wrestlers' backstories and whatnot. But there's so many of them that are like that. That again, it's just my podcast is just basically to kind of cut through that. If people are warned well enough about it, that, you know, it is a bit of a mickey take at some points, you know, there is a bit of humour in it, there is a bit of lightness in it, as opposed to, you know, just straightforward interviews, then it's, you know, it's something that I enjoy doing, and it means I can put a wee bit of work into it as well, you know, trying to figure out what direction to take it in, all that sort of stuff. So it's something that I've really enjoyed doing. It's something that I've tried in the past to get podcasts up and running, whether that's been football, ice hockey, whatever. But this has probably been the most well-received one of the lot of them.
And yeah, for ones I've listened to anyway, certainly it's a hybrid. That's pretty much what it is. It's kayfabe, yeah. But it's not kayfabe, but it is at the same time. But I get that because, obviously, my podcast is speaking to Scottish wrestlers, which is a niche in itself. And yeah. I think a lot of people don't realise, I mean, for me, when I'm working, or that I can't watch video, I shouldn't be watching videos. I don't watch videos. while I'm working, but I listen to podcasts. So if I get an audio medium, then I can learn about these characters, and shows only happen, they might only wrestle once a month. So what's happening during that month? Well, at least I know, oh, they do this, they do that. Mine did start as just straight up wrestling chat, half an hour, we'll speak about your wrestling career. And now it's gotten to the point where we'll speak about wrestling, but if I find something that I can spin off and speak about anything, but it took me a lot of effort not to go into Power Rangers when you mentioned them right near the start. I thought, no, I've got other notes I want to get to first before I probably end up going back to Power Rangers.
Bobby Diamond would be the guy to talk to about Power Rangers. He's still obsessed with it. But I think it's more of I was obsessed when I was like 9, 10. Not so much now, but Bobby, he's still firmly entrenched in it. He's still a big fan.
Oh, I gave up after like the third iteration of Power Rangers, but I have spoken to guys like Alistair, I keep forgetting his new name, Alistair Adams, and Jetstream Jack, and they're just obsessed with it. And it was, but yeah, best Power Ranger obviously is Tommy, but everyone's got their yeah. favourites. Jason was mine, even though you think it would be the Blue Ranger because he was Billy. But no, it was Jason was the best one. But yeah, it's just finding that niche. I mean, when I was looking for people to have on our network, just because I thought I just want to give opportunities. I sound really big headed when I go, I want to give people opportunities, but I just wanted people to hear other voices. And when you said, "Oh, can are you interested in putting hitting the headlines on?" I was like, "Yeah." And not just because, it's Northern Irish wrestling, it's just these new voices, but the fact that you're a Scottish voice as well, it was a no-brainer that I wanted a Scottish voice, and they've got their own thing as well. And I mean, I've learned things, and just as a behind the curtain, the little bit that I did for yours, which will be like a month before this actually goes out, I did that in one take, and I was so happy with it. And then the same day, I was asked to do a little like 30-second video intro for a podcast. It took me 6 takes because I kept looking at myself and got really self-conscious. But the audio one, I was just like, right, give me the bullet points, done. So I could be an arsehole in audio form, but if I'm doing it visually, it's a very terrifying experience.
I'm grateful that you did that as well, because it definitely added to it, and it's kind of given me this story arc for the next few weeks on the podcast. It's I was thinking of ways that I could challenge myself with the podcast as well, because I was really surprised when I was starting to look at stats on it. I was really surprised at where I was getting the listens from. You know, again, I don't know if it's because of my age or whatnot, or because media took a massive change after I got my degree in media, that I'm not too, you know, savvy with everything that goes on in it. But the YouTube seems to be where I'm getting the most views or listens or whatnot, and I never expected that would be the case, because I didn't think people would, you know, when I think a podcast is something that I listen to when I'm doing the dishes, when I'm going out for the run, when I'm doing my work, that kind of thing. I didn't think that YouTube would be the same would be anything. I just thought, you know, I've got the video there from doing the recordings and Zoom, I might as well do something with them. But YouTube's been the big thing for it. And again, since the ill-fated podcast with Rocky Star that took a turn at the end, the views have been consistent on there, which has been great. And the fact that now being on SWN is canon in the storyline of it, I think that's helping a lot as well, because there's that jeopardy that I don't get kept on.
Yeah, I'm in this like weird position where I'm like the Vince McMahon on yours. Not big headed at all, but like in my canon, I'm nice. So I'm like, it's like was it when Vince and that were doing Memphis? They had the feud in Memphis, but they were the faces there, but they're the heels, or vice versa. It's just like everyone listens to yours thinking, oh, this guy's a bit of a dick, and they listen to mine, and I'm going, what's your favourite dinosaur? And it's a very weird thing. I love doing it. If that's the closest I'm going to get to doing a wrestling storyline, I'll take it. Speaking of that stupid question, what is your favourite dinosaur?
I was discussing dinosaurs with my daughter the other day. She's 5 years old, and she was telling me all the dinosaurs that she knows, which topped out at Diplodocus. So T-Rex, Stegosaurus and Diplodocus. I don't think it's till primary three that they start doing dinosaurs properly at school. For me, I don't know. I think relating it back to wrestling. So obviously, when we was again going back to SummerSlam 90 as well, Hogan and Warrior were the big draws there. They were the T-Rex and the Velociraptors of it there. But then you have like Mr. Perfect and Texas Tornado being my favourite match in that. So the Allosaurus is kind of somewhere where it's not quite as big as the T-Rex. It doesn't get the headlines that the T-Rex gets. But the Allosaurus, it's just as vicious, just a wee bit smaller. It's the kind of the workhorse. It's having to work to get his reputation. So I'd say Allosaurus would be that. Or the Dilophosaurus in Jurassic Park. That made me shit the bed. So that'll be my one.
That's the one.
When I was wee, that thing freaked me out. It was like, I loved it and I hated it at the same time, because it looked so cute when, you know, Dennis Nedry's, you know, mucking about, falling over himself, spilling all the whatever it was he had in the cans. And then he's like, oh, and then it's like, ah, and like, nope, that's nightmares. That's the stuff of nightmares.
See, for that particular dinosaur, it's always forever be ruined by Ross from Friends doing the voice, what he thinks they'd sound like when he did the but favorite answer, I'll tell everyone knows this if they've been listening to this in canon, is still Turkey Dinosaur. That's the best one. Luchasaurus is also quite high up there. But for anyone listening and is going to get this question asked in the future, nobody has said the dinosaur that JBL fights when he's tranquilized, and that's a high scoring answer in my brain. So. Just saying. The other question that we have is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Who would win in a fight?
Yeah.
So two sheep fight and one cow?
Yeah.
So handicap match, those. Is the cow the face or the heel?
I'll leave that to your own interpretation.
It's a cow.
Cows are usually heels, aren't they?
I don't know, like sheep can be but
I know, but you don't go to someone, oh, they're quite a nice cow. No, it's just
I've been inside a cow. I've been Clangus. Oh, so I've got that.
Oh, so you have? Yes. What a rabbit's going there. Funny.
Yeah, no, not like that. Again, there's a bit in Freddy Get Fingered that's very similar to that as well. But yeah, I think the cow would probably win. No, if I'm looking at that, if we're going Highland cow, and normal size sheep, you're looking at Big Show B2 jobbers in that regard, and just gonna swat them about, you know. Cow for me.
See, you're only the second person to bring up a Highland cow. Molly was last week's episode or whatever. We are at this stage, and she said, "If it's a Highland cow, they're winning." So that seems to be a new wrinkle in this question. But
see, the thing with that is, she's a big Fife Flyers fan, who are the sworn enemies of Glasgow Clan and said Clangus. So that's interesting that she would go for the Highland cow when it probably goes against everything she believes in to do so.
Well, it must have been a couple of knocks in that cage that did it. It just went, oh, maybe I quite like them after all. Right, so what have you been doing during lockdown then? You've done the Hitting the Headline podcast. Are you watching anything? Is there anything that's keeping you active? Gym activities, so, whatever.
Well, last year, in the first lockdown last year, that was all about doing the home workouts and stuff. And to an extent, they worked. They were keeping me active. But I just, after the while, I think I did them from like May, from April to August. I was doing home workouts pretty much every day. Saw a bit of improvement. Put on some muscle mass, which was always good. And then my work, my real life work, got really busy. Then about August time, didn't have the same amount of time to commit to the home workouts and stuff. And I just started eating. Put on the weight that I'd put on in a good way got sacrificed for getting put on in a bad way. So I ballooned up to a fat 15 stone. So since the turn of the year, I've been on a diet using the horrifically named Pinch of Norm recipe books. And I've managed to get down to 13 stone 9. So that's been my kind of focus for getting back to being ring fit. Like this, like by the time we, as long as I don't have a relapse and just get stuck into the Whisper Golds again, by the time we get back to being in the ring, it'll be the lightest I've ever been as a wrestler, which will be good because it means I can stop sandbagging folk. But yeah, that's been the focus this year, just dropping a bit of weight. I've been homeschooling with my wee one. I've not been as busy as I would have liked to have been with my own work. Just before I started my current job, just I think it was 8 weeks before lockdown kicked in last year. So I've been lucky enough, I've been able to do all of that from home. But yeah, just existing, really. Just been existing, really missing Scotland. Usually I would get back home to Scotland maybe once every couple of months, or Scotland would come to me every couple of months. But it's now over a year since I've been home, missing that terribly. Missing my mum and my family and my cousins and my cousins' dogs, missing seeing my mates, missing getting over for football, wrestling shows. I'd planned to try and get back over for some ICW stuff last year if it was going to be on, but that's never happened. I was trying to organise. So a couple of years back for my cousin's stag, I had hooked up with Red Lightning about doing a day at the asylum, as the stag do. Getting a load of guys that have never been in a wrestling ring to go in and do drills and promos and stuff. And it was great. It was absolutely great. And just before lockdown last year, I'd been in touch with Udo in regards to maybe getting some of our boys to go over there for a training weekend or something. But obviously, we've never been able to make that happen because of lockdown. In terms of things I've been watching, get right into watching AEW. I've really enjoyed having something to look forward to weekly, or I was until the streaming service that may or may not be illegal I was using to watch it stopped putting it on. So I've had to invest in Fight Network over the last couple of weeks to remedy that. I've been listening to a lot of Jim Cornette as well, which is probably not a great thing. And it's kind of shaping my view on certain things in AEW, but again, you need to look at it with your own eyes as well as that of a grumpy man in his 60s. But I do enjoy it for the most part. There's a lot that I can tune out. I've been quite vocal on my podcast in the past saying that I don't, and again, no, I think it's got better over the last wee while, but I don't think at the time that they started in television that the women's division was ready to be in television. But they've certainly, you know, with everything that went on in the previous week, to the Colin with Britt Baker and Thunder Rosa, they've really kind of upped everything on that. I thought that was a phenomenal bit of television, not just a phenomenal bit of wrestling, but a phenomenal bit of TV last week with that unsanctioned match. Really enjoyed watching that and seeing what they put them through. The powerbomb and the thumbtacks actually, like, winced so hard that I fell off my couch watching it. I just looked, because when you're a guy and you're watching men get powerbombed or getting powerbombed yourself, you know that you're at least 6 foot, maybe higher, off the ground when you're coming down, so you've got time to prep for that bump, whether it's on thumbtacks or not. But because Thunder Rosa is so short, there's not a lot of distance for Britt Baker to travel. And that, so you know that she's getting all that impact, you know, so quickly. I was just like, oh, brutal, absolutely brutal. But it was, again, and I'm not a fan of, you know, death matches, hardcore matches, that kind of thing. But that was, it was sublime watching that. I really, really enjoyed it. But I think one of the things that lockdown's allowed me to do as well is, I've been able to watch pretty much every pay-per-view that's been on and not have to worry about, you know, being knackered and getting up to Belfast in the morning. I've been able to, you know, just go for it. And after we record this, I'm looking forward to watching Fastlane because it starts before midnight. You know, I'm not going to be up till 5 o'clock tomorrow morning.
So excited for that in itself. Are you Thunderdoming?
I'm not Thunderdoming for that. I've only done that the once. I did that stupidly the night before my wee girl's 5th birthday, and I was like a zombie the next day for the party. I'm doing Thunderdome for that. But yeah, it's a strange experience. Again, I think I talked about that in one of the wrestling dafts that I was on. It's just, you're basically just selling. You're selling for the whole 2 hours of the show. because you're having to react to everything that's going on as if you are actually there. It's a strange experience watching it.
I know. I've booted out now 3 times, and because I did quite a few of them. I only missed like 2 pay-per-views last year on the Thunderdome. Yeah, I got booted out for booing Sasha Banks. Had to be, because I booed her, then I got booted. I got booted just after Drew lost to Randy Orton, because I swore really loudly, and I think that's what got me booted. And then the last one, I got booted out because I had a massive logo on my t-shirt for Superkicks. So I think they finally just went, "Is he just wearing a big logo on his t-shirt?" And I was gone. I was out. So, yeah, it's an experience, but pretty much, yeah, you're just told. Although, I think they're still not getting it. If they need to tell us what to do if we want to stay in, because they just go, "Oh, what do you think of Sasha Banks? Well, I find her particularly annoying, so I'm going to boo her." No, that's not the answer we're looking for. You have to cheer her. That is the point. Like, no, it's like, just tell me. Cheer Sasha Banks. I will cheer Sasha Banks. It's not that difficult.
I found it really jarring watching NXT UK last week. Like, I don't often dip into it, but I've been intrigued by this Trent Seven storyline. I think it's because he's been trying to drop weight at the same time I've been trying to drop weight. So I think that's where it kicked in. But I put it on, and they've got like people from the Thunderdome on the walls at the BT Studios for the NXT UK, but they're clearly not for NXT UK, because you don't get the email saying, "Do you want to be in Thunderdome for NXT UK?" So it must just be like a load of recorded faces that they're playing about with to make the crowd in there. But it just seemed bizarre to think that they've got that crowd of people that have probably been watching, you know, Apollo Crews and Big E from SmackDown the week before, watching Miko Satomura and... I forget what was that was on last week. But, you know, it's just the actions from a completely different match.
So I may have appeared on NXT UK for all I know. So that's interesting. Same with NXT. NXT had they still got their screens, but you don't get an email. So I assume again it's just reused footage, which is weird. So back to your podcast. I know I've now got you for an hour and a half. So we'll try it. Everyone tries to get a new tactical nap in, or try to, before a wrestling pay-per-view. So I'll ask a couple more questions, and then I'll let you more so for me to get a nap before the show.
I'm totally on board with that. My fear is that I miss the first hour, because I'm that used to like setting an alarm for midnight instead of 11.
That's fine then. So as far as your interviews, like I say, I'm so glad that you said Alexa Bliss is nice, because I want her to be nice, because she's like my absolute favourite. Not just because she's very pretty, but she's a very good wrestler, and she's such a Disney nerd that I love hearing her on podcasts speak about Disney and her passions for things like NSYNC and all that kind of stuff. She just sounds like an absolute blast. But what's been your favourite of your interviews, with big names like Samoa Joe or Finn Balor, or with not so big names, but ones that are coming up, like Eli Fox and Bobby Diamond?
It's weird with the local guys, because I was saying to my wife the other week there when I was having Diamond Craig DL on. Like, Craig is a long-time friend of mine from uni. We shared a flat in Denniston back in 2005, and we started writing a sitcom based on wrestling without having any knowledge of the wrestling industry at all. And it was great having him back on. And I was saying to my wife that it's a shame that the most I've spoken to him at length since last year has been through the podcast. You know, it's almost as if I'm having to fabricate reasons to speak to my mates. Because that's pretty much the only way that I've really connected with guys for wrestling over the last year is through the podcast. Because it's very hard to have conversations at training when you are punching each other, kicking each other, suplexing each other. It's very hard to get a proper conversation with people. At least I find it to be quite hard. And again, as a 35-year-old male, it's quite hard to make new friends, like, in any situation, and especially, you know, being in a foreign country, so to speak. It's quite difficult. But the podcast allowed me to do that. So any opportunity that I've had to speak to any of the guys from Titanic has been great. So those interviews have been nice to do. But in terms of like proper, you know, interviews with big names, as much as I was kicking myself after the Jericho one, like Jericho's my all-time favourite. Like he's my, and I think it's because like, this is going to sound really strange, I've got a lot of parallels with him in terms of he wrestles, I kind of wrestle. He's in a band, I was in a band for a good number of years back in the day. He does a podcast, I do a podcast. We've got a lot of, you know, we've got a lot of things in it that we enjoy together. So when the opportunity came to interview him, I wasn't allowed to talk to him about wrestling. That was the kicker on it. I wasn't, because he was on Fozzie duty, I wasn't allowed to talk to him about wrestling. And the day, it was a Tuesday that I interviewed him. He was playing in Belfast on the Sunday. So I went to the show on the Sunday, which was really bizarre as well. It was a really odd show. But I'd done that. But I was told that I couldn't speak to him about the wrestling. But the week before I was speaking to him was when he started his Twitter stuff with Kenny Omega. So I was like, I really want to ask a question about that. But because I made a bollocks of a bit of the interview, he kind of hurried me off the end of it. And I didn't get a chance to mention anything about the Kenny Omega stuff. So he had the show in Belfast on the Sunday. And the week later, he showed up at the, or his video thing showed up at the Tokyo Dome. And I was like, I had him at the perfect point to talk to him about the biggest thing that his career would do, like this decade. And I couldn't talk to him about it. And I balled it up. So yeah, that's probably been my favourite one. And for whatever reason, when I was doing the interview with him, he gave me, like, he phoned me from his own actual proper phone number and didn't hide it, he didn't block it. So I had Y2J saved in my phone for the longest time, and I was like, this is a lot of responsibility for me not to do this. And I was like, because I looked up the area code that was on it, and it was, you know, like Tampa, Florida, whatever it was he was staying. And I was like, that's his actual number. That's his proper number. So the Tokyo Dome match with Kenny Omega, it got to that. And I don't know what possessed me. I fired them off a text. And I was like, that was brilliant. Well done on your match. Just thinking, you know, the number would be disconnected. And he texted me back saying, thanks very much, dude. Thanks for the support. And I was like, this is mental. I now have a link. But he's since changed his number because he's never responded to anything else that I've sent him since. I don't know. But I've got a few fairly big names, not to boast or anything like that, but I've got a few fairly big names from doing the work that I've been doing in my phone book. Because of the challenge that you laid down to me to get the 300 listeners by WrestleMania week, I thought, I'll see if there's any of those big guns that I can pull up. So I fired off a couple of text messages, and one of them sent me a very lovely voice note back to say that he'd be very interested, and I was messaging with him earlier on today to get that organised. So in the next couple of weeks, there'll be a former WWE tag team champion that'll be making its way onto the SWN, as long as we can get the time difference sorted, and as long as he's not too high to facilitate it.
So for those that are listening to on the Patreon, that's a big tease, because this is supposed to come out May 28th, and the challenge will be over by then. So
the challenge will be done by then.
Yeah, so we're hoping that it all works out, and it'll be.
And I'd say as well that this person that's going to be on, my previous encounters with them is probably my favourite thing that's happened to me being involved in the world of Northern Irish wrestling as well. It was, and I'll probably go into a lot of detail on that in the podcast that I do with them. So if you're listening now, go back to WrestleMania week and listen to Hitting the Headlines and then to find out what the hell I'm actually talking about.
I think that's the perfect way to kind of wrap this up then, that little teaser. So where can people find you on social media?
So if you're looking for the headline maker, Kirk Cooper, it's at Kirk Cooper HM on Instagram and Twitter. Again, just like I was kind of flummoxed as to YouTube getting me higher views, I tend to get a lot more engagement over on Instagram than I do on Twitter with my wrestling stuff, which I find baffling because I don't really know how to use it. And you can find me on the Scottish Wrestling Network under Hitting the Headlines on there. And hopefully by the time you're listening to this, there will maybe be some Titanic Wrestling stuff that will either have happened or will be coming up, which may be getting streamed in places if we can get that working. If not, keep a lookout for anything to do with Titanic Wrestling on the socials as well, because we've got a brilliant roster full of hungry talent that have been chomping at the bit for the last year to get back at it. We've got some of the best trainers in Northern Ireland and Ireland affiliated with us. We've got a raft of guys that are capable of putting on great matches, some great characters as well. And I just can't wait for everyone to get back at it. And hopefully, depending on what the landscape of wrestling shows is going to be, whether it is going to be, you know, shows getting streamed on YouTube, Twitch, Facebook, whatever, or if we're able to get people in, I'm hopeful that we can get the audience that we deserve and get things back to a level where we can be going out and entertaining people and making some new names. Because no disrespect to guys like Tucker, JDP, Rocky, Luther, Big Tron as well. You know, these guys are still going to be very much at the forefront of the Northern Irish scene. But, you know, we've got hungry guys like Eli Fox, Jordy Boy, James Toner, Jamesy Mullen, Amira Blair, who's, you know, she's doing great stuff over on Instagram in terms of, you know, building her wrestling reputation. We've got Myla Grace, Sky James, Bobby Diamond. We've got loads and loads of up-and-coming talent that if you've not heard them on the podcast, I'll be trying to get them on soon, or you can just do a quick search for Northern Ireland Wrestling on the socials and whatnot and blank out all the bad stuff about it and focus on the good stuff, and you'll find some absolute gems, as well as the boys from down south as well, the boys and girls like Amy Alonzi. I mean, you just need to look at who's in NXT UK just now. You've got the likes of Jordan Devlin, Aoife Valkyrie. Those are people that have passed through the doors of PWU in the past, of wrestled for Titanic Wrestling, and the guys down in Fake Factory, there's going to be a long list of them coming through as well. So yeah, Northern Irish Wrestling and Irish Wrestling, once we can get back to doing shows, is probably going to be a good jumping off point for the future of wrestling in the British Isles. And I know that the ones down south don't want to be lumped in with being British, but there's a lot of talent down there that deserve to get that recognition.
Excellent. Well, perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me today.
No problem. Thanks for having me, Billy. Cheers.